Who's using modern SQL? Ah, one. That's the reason why you are here. SQL, you know, is a pretty old programming language. It has its origins in the year 74. But I will skip a lot of this very old stuff. And I will give you a quick tour about what has changed in the past 20 years mostly. But before I can do so and show you the awesome new features which we have got since then, really mind-blowing features, we have to establish some common grounds of what happened before that. The relational idea. You know the relational concept? Yes. First of all, I would like to skip over a few decades to just the year 92 when SQL 92 was released. It was a very important release of the standard. But we have now something more powerful. But first I need to establish these common grounds, what we are talking about. What were the limits in SQL 92? And SQL 92 was mostly tied to the relational idea. And that relational idea has actually two components. First of all, the relational model. And in there, there was at the original definition the concept of atomic types. So yeah, you have one of them. What was it about? So when they described what a table is, then they said every single cell must contain one value out of one of atomic type. So this is what this definition was used for. So you can fill up tables out of these atomic types. And if you look closely, you see there's one gap. And that was already one exception SQL made. It allowed for the null value. So it kind of broke the original idea of the relational model. But then let's go on. The second interesting idea there was that the schema design, the persistent schema design, should be independent of the processing purposes, what you plan to do with the data. That's a very important concept which is still there. Whatever you store persistently should not be tied to whatever you plan to do with that. And this is what we call actually normalization. And you might know all of these normalization levels from first, second, and so on until sixth, and then a few more. Forget about them. Just take the word normalization and think about that. Just the word. What is it about? Just consider the true nature of the data itself and store it according to the nature of the data. Forget about what you plan to do with the data, or where it comes from. Just look at the data itself. This is what will last, and this is what will remain. And this is what you need to design your schema for. And you know that one of the consequences out of that is that you will spread all your data in multiple tables. Who knows that problem? Yeah, everybody. So here comes the second component of this. This is the relational model. And the second component of the relational idea is that we have relational transformations, like join operations, for example. And the idea was that if you have this normalized, persisted data, and you can transform it on the fly over into any other form which is more convenient for one particular processing purpose. So whatever you want to do, you just transform it on the fly. And of course you have many different processing purposes in one application. And every single time you have a tool to transform this in a different shape, in whatever shape you need it for each of those processing purposes. And the great benefit of this is, what is immutable is the nature of the data itself. You might need to add one attribute at a time. That's no problem. You can add another attribute to a table. But you don't need to do big changes when your requirements change. And one of the problems we know, one of these agility things we cope with nowadays, is we know that we don't know the requirements of the future. So if we tie our data model, our persistent data model, to what we know now, then it might be handy now, but it will not be useful in the near future. And the idea at that time already was to forget about all the processing purposes and just focus at the data itself, and then for each processing purpose we transform it. And SQL is meant to be this transformation language. This is what it was from the beginning. also in SQL 92. But what has changed since then is that it's not tied to the relational model anymore. So let's go on. This was SQL 92, and pretty much everybody knows what SQL 92 is and what SQL 92 could do. Then the next release was SQL 99. And there we have great news. The relational data model is dead. This was the title of a paper published around that time when SQL 99 was released by the International Standards Organization. And what it says, I will give you two quotes to get an idea. The relational data model is dead. One of the quotes is, to say that these SQL 99 extensions are mere extended interpretations of the relational data model is like saying the intercontinental ballistic missile is like a mere extension of a spear. So there is the concept of some extended interpretation of the relational model. I will come back to that in a moment. But you see the difference between spear and intercontinental ballistic missile. And another quote from there is, with SQL 99, you get the best of both worlds, and of course, you can get the worst of both worlds. It's up to the database practitioners, that's us, to do the right thing. We have the choice. SQL does not dictate us to use relational concepts. It never did, actually, but it does less so since then. So what is it about? What is it about this extended interpretation of the relational data model? Extended interpretation. How did it change? And here I would like to quote Chris Date, for the reason that Chris Date, he wrote about that, so he's easy to quote. And he wrote, I was confused as anyone else. But what was he confused about? And he was confused about the atom. What is it? What is the atom in the relational data model? You remember the atom is what we have put into table cells. And it was said that each entry there, each value, must be of an atomic type. But he was questioning, okay, what is an atomic type? Because if I take a string, it is actually considered an atomic type, but it's not atomic. I can split it into characters. It's not atomic. If I take a date, like today's day, I can split it into year, month, day, and so on. It's not atomic. And if you follow this argument, you will find out that the only truly atomic unit we have of information is a single bit. That's atomic. Okay? But again, if you think that this word atomic was used to describe what you can put in a table cell, then it makes absolutely no sense to say each and every table cell can only contain one single bit. I mean, that's insane. That's clearly not what was meant. So he asked, what is meant, actually? And can we find a more concise definition of that? Very much like nowadays, we are redefining, actually, what a kilogram is. Have you heard of that? Yeah? So it's redefined and more concise. We are not going to this thing in Paris anymore. We are going to a sphere somewhere else, one which is easy to reproduce. So more concise definitions, that's what scientists aim for. And at that time he was wondering, okay, what other word could we use there instead of atomic, because atomic somehow doesn't work out. And by the early 1990s, however, seen the light in this confusion, and what he found was that domains can contain anything. And in this context, domains just means types can be anything. Anything. Really anything. And this is the idea SQL 99 took up. So they introduced rich data types into the SQL standard. And it's of course still valid to put these atomic types there. You can still have a string there, of course, and they are still the most useful types. But now we have, in the international SQL standard, we have arrays. You can have a column which is an array of something. And it's perfectly valid. It's not breaking the current interpretation, the extended interpretation of the relational data model. In the original data definition, they said no repeating groups. Who has heard that? No repeating groups. That was in the original definition. It's gone. It's not true anymore. You can have repeating groups. We have an explicit feature for that. And it goes even further. We can have nested tables. You can put an entire table into a table cell. And of course, we have composite types, like objects, if you would like to say it that way. So you could combine, like for monetary value, you can take the number and the currency symbol and combine them into one logical type. And then when you use SQL to do transformations, you will even enjoy type safety, because SQL is a statically typed language. So that's the one side of it, the relational data model. You can put anything in any cell and it doesn't break anything. It's still fine. On the other hand, on the transformation side, we have got more operations. We don't try to do anything with joins anymore. We have more richer operations, and one of them is the transitive closure, and for that I would like to show you an example. So imagine you have a table like I have sketched up there, and it's basically implementing a hierarchy. So in each of these cells you can basically have a parent pointer, and I think I have like 16 nodes there, so I would have 16 rows in this table. And of course, if I know the ID, I can pick any of them quite easily, where ID equals something. But then the question is, how can I find all of the descendant nodes? And that's one of the problems where SQL 92 did not have a good solution for. But now we have, and I would like to show you. So it starts with selecting this root node. If you know the ID, like ID 42, then you can just pick it. And then the first step is still quite easy, because that's actually coming from SQL 92. You can do union all to add further rows to the result. And there you see I have done a trick. I'm using the same ID, so let's say 42, to search, but I'm not searching on the ID column, but on the parent column, which gives me the first level of childs. And here we have it. Game over. When it comes to SQL 92. We cannot easily add another level there, because we don't have the grandparent relationships, and of course we don't want to hard code anything like that. And this is what we can now solve with SQL 99, and it's actually quite easy. The idea is just to reuse the output of my own query as input of the query itself. And the syntax is just a few lines. That's it. And I have this indirection in there to refer to my own output. I'm referring to the output of my own query, so that when I get the IDs of one level, I instantly start searching for them on the parent relationship for the next level. And when I run this query, I will immediately hit all of these childs. And that's now in there in the international standard since SQL 99. And when you look at the databases, I've checked a few databases for you. Which of them supported? By now, pretty much every major SQL database supports that kind of query. So photos are taken. I will later on tweet the slides. So this is just one of the features introduced with SQL 99. 99 was a really groundbreaking standard. You have seen all the different types that were introduced. I did not mention them in detail, just to get the idea. It was really a big one, and this is one of the transformation steps you can now do, which you could not do before. But I would like to go on. The next SQL standard was released in 2003, and there I would like to show you another groundbreaking revolution, if you want to say so. You see here XML. So why is it groundbreaking? Because now we have actually a document store in SQL, and there is no common schema anymore between different documents in different rows. This is what has actually changed there. So we have this kind of schema-less thinking, non-uniform documents in a single column. This was first introduced with SQL 2003. Later on, and I will show you that, we have got JSON as well. So SQL has JSON support now, and yeah, most databases support that to some extent. And on the transformation side, we have got analytical functions, window functions, and they are so popular that most NoSQL databases have also implemented them. So I've shown you a few in there. So I would like to show you an example of what is this analytical window functions, what is it about? If you think of a table like a query like this, which might give you a result like you see on the right-hand side, it's basically transactions. So it means like somebody made a deposit of 10 and another deposit of 20 and then a withdrawal of 10 and so on. And I would like to add another column that tells me what is the balance as of that point in time, as of that transaction. So in the first one, when it starts with 0, it's 10. On the second one, it's then 30. If I take 10 out again, then it's down to 20, and so on and so on. How can you do that with SQL? And actually, it's very, very easy nowadays, because we have these so-called window functions. All we have to do is, if we want to build some aggregate, some sum over that, we can do so, but previously we had to use a group by to make that work, and that we don't have to do anymore. We can now use aggregates without group by. That's the game changer here. Instead of group by, we have to use another way to declare over which rows those aggregates shall be applied, which input rows shall be given to the sum function there. And this is what we do with the over clause. And in the over clause, we start by talking to the database. It's like, hey, listen, database, I'm going to use terms like before and after in a moment. And so that these terms, before and after, make sense, let's say these refer to that order. So you first agree on an order with the database. It's basically a chronological order. And then you can say, I would like to summarize those rows which are between unbounded preceding, and that basically means just the very first row, and the current row. Here it is. And you see these two pointers. And at every single row, the database looks at this window, and at every single row, that window is different. In the first row, it just captures the first row, so it summarizes the first row only and gives you 10. In the second row, it covers two rows already. So it will summarize those two rows, which gives you 30. And so on, and so on. And this is declarative programming. We have just seen in the keynote that there is declarative programming, okay? That's what SQL is about. So just declare what you would like to have. You describe the result. And yeah, can you use that yet? Yes, even SQLite has implemented it. Okay, who is using SQLite? Ah, you can use it. Just a recent version. Maybe not on your Android now, but yeah. Yeah, it's there. It's an international standardized feature for 15 years, and it is pretty much every database available by now, even in many, many, many NoSQL databases. So let's go on. I'm skip over a few versions of the SQL standard here. I'm skipping immediately to the latest version. So the latest version is from 2016. And there, I've already told you, we have got JSON support. So what is it about? JSON is basically documents. You know how they look like? Okay. Now, SQL has a semantic understanding of what these things are. It now knows what the square bracket means, and what the curly bracket means, and what the colons means, and how to escape special characters in the strings. You can now ask questions like, what is it? Is it an array? Is it an object? And if it is an array, how many elements does it have? You can ask questions like this. And you can transform, because SQL is a transformation language. You can transform, for example, into a more atomic table design. When you say, okay, I have here an array containing two elements with two objects, basically. I would like to transform that into two rows and each of the attributes in the object into a column. SQL has that, and it's not complex. I'll show you the example. It fits on the slide. Here it is. This is the query that transforms that JSON document into that table. It's as simple as that. What is it about? So first of all, you have to provide the JSON input data in some way. Of course, I'm using a bind parameter here, because nobody likes SQL injection. And then we declare what we would like to have. And when you declare something in SQL, you have to declare the columns and you have to declare the rows. And in this example, it starts with the rows. So we are using a special new language called SQL JSON Path, which is actually very similar like XPath for XML. Who knows XPath for XML? Okay, it's also similar to CSS selectors for HTML. Who knows CSS selectors? Okay, it's the same thing. If you have a JSON document, you can describe using this language, you can pick some of the items out of that. And the parse expression I have here, this one, It basically says start at the root, expect an array there, and take all the elements. That's the star inside there. So what it does, it hits those two objects. And in this function, JSON table, it basically means the many objects it this expression hits, you will get as many rows in the result. So this is why we declare that we would like to have two rows in the result. We just might make an expression that hits the objects we want to transfer into rows. And that's it, then we go on and we declare the columns. And you see it, there's a columns clause, and you can just say, you can give it a name, ID and A1, you give it a type like in SQL, and again you use JSON parse expressions to tell, okay, this is an object now and I would like to take the attribute ID and A1 out of it and map it into columns. And that's it. You have just transformed a JSON document into a more atomic table design. But you may wonder, why? Why would I do that? Why would I send from a client via bind parameter a JSON document to a SQL database just to get it back in another form? And I agree, that's not good, no good use case. Unless you use the composability power of SQL. Because you could easily prefix this with insert into something, into a table, and then you write that into more in an atomic table design. You just from the client send your JSON to the database. The database does the transformation and inserts it into some target table right away. There is no need to transform that JSON on your client side. You can just put it to the database and in a declarative way transform it there and insert it there. And SQL 2016 has introduced many, many more functions also to transform in the other way, from a more atomic table design to a document style. All of that is there. You can query, you can ask questions. Is it JSON? And if it is JSON, what is it? Is it array object? How many objects does it have? Which elements does it have? It's all there. You can transform back and forth all the time. So this was introduced with SQL 2016 into the international standard, and well, it's a rather young feature. So if we look at that matrix, at that overview here in the timeline, you can see that not many databases are supporting this particular feature yet, but it is for SQL rather young, and I know that at least Postgres is working on that. There was like last week a commit on the master branch, which is the first step in supporting that. Who's using Postgres here? Okay, so maybe in 12 a little bit out of that is coming for you. Conceptual, does it work like a lateral view? Yes, it's a table function, basically. This particular JSON table function. Yeah. Okay. And then I would like to go on to really blow your mind. My favorite feature in SQL 2016. Welcome row pattern matching. Who knows that? Row pattern matching. Match recognize is the clause for that. Okay, be prepared. Imagine you have a time series, and you know time series are extremely important right now. Everybody is collecting click streams and event streams and wants to process them. Okay. So what I have here is a time series, and there are events coming in at irregular intervals. Let's say this is something like a web log or so. And I have this 30 minutes units. And I have a definition which basically says, whatever happens in 30 minutes continues a session. And if you have a gap which is longer than 30 minutes, then it stops the old session, and if the next event just starts a new session. So like in weblogs, so how many sessions did we have? How can you do that in SQL? And I will first of all show you the, how should I tell it, the scary solution. Yeah, I'm sorry. It's not actually complex. I won't go into the details, but you see there is several levels of nesting. What it basically does is at the innermost level, it's marking, it's putting a tag on each event that starts a new session. So if you look in the time up here, then you see I'm marking the first event that starts a new session. And then in the next step, when we go one level outside, we are basically just counting how many of these tags have we seen in a chronological order. And then you see that the first event gets the 1, and then here it increments to 2 because there's the second circle, but those remain at the same because they are counting the start flags, which I've set. And now you have a common criteria on all of these events for each session, so you can do whatever you like. In this query, I'm doing then a group by session number, but now you can basically work on a per session basis with that. And this is start of group tagging. It's the common technique to solve this. There are a few other ways to do it, but you see there's some complexity in there. And now welcome this small little boy. Who is that? Anybody? Ah, it's a regular expression. Who knows regular expressions? Oh, come on. Well, who likes regular expression? Maybe who can work with regular expression, at least simple ones already? Yeah? So many people don't need to learn anything new here. That's the interesting part. Because you already know in regular expressions are there to match characters. So they work on character basis, basically. So the dot means match any character. The backslash uppercase S means match any non-whitespace character. You might not know that by heart, but okay, it's easy enough to look up, or you could use character classes or anything like that. So okay, that's easy. And you know, of course, the asterisk. It's a star. Match 0 or more of the previous one. You know that already, okay? Who basically understands that regular expression? Yeah. And that regular expression is basically what we need to match our sessions in our log file scenario. So what it works like, this is the entire query. It's the same query as before. There's no nesting anymore. There's just a new feature called match recognize, which is used to apply regular expressions to match against rows. And this is the main difference there. We are using the regular expression logic, like the asterisk as a quantifier, also the question mark, and all of these things you know already from regular expressions. But we are not matching characters. Instead, we are matching rows. And for that, we need to define a vocabulary. Like in regular expressions, in string regular expressions, basically every character matches itself except a few special characters, like the dot. But how could you match a row with that syntax? So the first step is at the bottom. We need to define a vocabulary. And here I'm defining a term called cont. And I say cont is true whenever the timestamp of the current row is less than the timestamp of the previous row plus 30 minutes. This is my condition. If this is true, then the next row belongs to the same session as the previous one. And if the gap is longer, then I cannot match this row against cont. And once I have defined the vocabulary, then I can use patterns, like regular expressions. What I have here is, I'm saying match any row, but there's no quantifier. So it matches any row, but exactly one of them. So one row is matched, no matter what it is. And then it tries to match as many cons as it can. Because there's the star, it's greedy, like in regular expressions. You can put a question mark after that to make it not greedy. It's regular expression, okay? So it tries to match as many of these cont as it can. And as soon as it finds a gap which is more than 30 minutes, then it cannot match any more cont. So it will stop that match. And then a new match might start over, a second session in that case. And now you have that match, these rows that match this pattern. You have them in your hands and you can process them. You can, for example, like group by, you can say, I would like in my result to get only one row for each match, only one. So I'm basically doing a group by. You can do that right there. You can also say all rows per match. It's there. Use what you need. And finally, you define the columns again. Don't ask me why this clause is called measures. It would also make sense if you would call it select, because it's basically what select does. You define the columns. And here I'm just defining a column which gets the last timestamp of a match, like you see here in the pointer, minus the first timestamp in a match. And this is the duration of this session. And that's basically it. Of course, we need an order by to establish the chronological order, but that's it. And you have the full power, almost the full power, of regular expressions applied to rows, typically events. And that's there recently. We are here in SQL 2016, the international standard. And yeah, you see one vendor who is already offering that, who is using Oracle. Okay, who is using Oracle 12? Yeah, you can use that. You already paid for it. I don't want to know how much, but you better make good use of it. I mean, it's there. Linear, it's awesome. Let's put it that way. If you have backtracking and all of these things, it's still regular expressions. You have a lot of complexity when it comes to finding matches. You know how, if you know how regular expressions work, then you will understand that, okay, sometimes it matches some things and finds out, okay, I cannot go further. I need to go back and try another path. So there is some complexity, but you can control it by the complexity you have in the regular expression. And you can apply the knowledge you already have. And I find that really mind-blowing. Who likes that idea? At least. Okay, so let me blow your mind once more. And let's go back in time. Because who would like to do some time traveling? Yeah, everybody likes time traveling. Back to the future, why not? Yeah, we have time traveling in SQL since 2011. So what is it about? There are two different versions of time traveling in SQL, because it turns out you need two different time axes to model all the cases you might have. The one is called application versioning, and it is used to model when something happened in the real world. Like if you think of name changes, a typical problem we all have to cope with in our business applications. A name if you marry, for example, and you change your name, when will your business partners, like bank, insurances, and whatever, when will they learn about it? Instantly or just weeks later? Of course, weeks later, because first you go on honeymoon, then you write many letters to all your business partners telling, my name has changed, here's the certificate, please take care of it. And application versioning is designed to model when the change happened in the real world, so at the day of marriage, even if we learned about it later or even earlier. Both ways are possible. So this is application versioning. I won't go into so much details. There's new syntax for that in SQL. So for example, you can now say, you can make an update, and there's a for portion of. And you can say, okay, I'm going to update the name for portion of that day until future. You can just say things like, okay, that happened at that point in time. And there's special syntax to take care of that. But the other one, the system versioning, is which I would like to tell you in more detail about. So what is that about? This models not when something happened in the real world, but when we learned about something. So when we go back to the marriage example, we learn about something when we receive the letter from our client that they changed their name. That might be weeks later. Okay? That's a different thing. But the benefit of this thing is it can be automated. Because all we need to take is the current timestamp. We learned about it now. We don't need such explicit syntax. Because all we need to know, okay, if I do an update now, then okay, then I learned about it now. So this is the big difference there. It's mostly transparent. There is also a little bit new syntax. I will show it in the example. But that new syntax is just to answer questions of the past. How did this database look like, let's say, 2 weeks ago? So how does it work, this system versioning, which is mostly transparent and fully automatic for you? Once you enable it, like shown here, it works. So you have to do a little bit setup. You have to provide two columns. I call them from and till of some timestamp type. And you have to tell the database, take care of these columns. And there we have the clauses generated always as row start and row end. And once we have done so, we are not allowed to fiddle around with these columns anymore. We don't update them. We have delegated that to the database. It's done. We don't care about them. We have to combine them into something called a period. So it's just saying these two columns should be taken. We have to explicitly do that. And then we enable with system versioning. And now the magic happens. If you insert something into this table, you don't mention those two columns because we have delegated that work to the database. We have declared database take care of it. So the database does take care of it if we don't mention them. It will set up the current time into the from column, and it will basically say open-ended in the to column, in the till column. And then, of course, if we do an update, magic happens again. We end up with two physical rows in that table. And the database will take care to set the from and till date so that it makes logically sense. So the old data, the X row, now has a till date when I do that at 11 o'clock. And the second row, which is also physically there, is now from now till open-ended. And of course, you guess it, if you delete it, nothing is deleted. We just logically delete it by setting the till time on this row. And all of that magically. You don't change your application. It just works. You have to consider, so the question is, when I say it works, I still have to create an index. Of course, all the indexes you have might need to consider that in some way. There are different ways how it is actually implemented in different databases. Like some databases do it like splitting the current rows into a partition and keeping the old rows away. So then all the queries that go for the current row don't need to have any index changes. But on the old rows, then you need to consider it. That really depends on how you set it up then in detail. Of course, indexing is something, yeah, performance is something you have to take care. You have to take these implicit conditions into consideration for some databases, depending on how it actually works. Yeah. You still have primary keys or constraints that's unaffected by that. So if you have a constraint on ID1, you cannot put a second active row at the same time in there. But you can have multiple with non-overlapping intervals. The same value. It really depends on your constraints. It's all up to the constraints. If you don't have any constraints, then you can insert as much as you like. That doesn't change. That's the interesting thing. The primary key, if you have ID here as a primary key, it is still valid because it makes sure only one of them is active at a time and there are no overlaps in the historic version. So as of each instant in time, the constraint is maintained. Another question. How would what?
A select,
yeah, that's what on the next slide. So I'll go to the select. So we have now deleted everything. Basically, it's still there physically somewhere. So if you query it, you see nothing because it's transparent. So what do we keep it for? And there we have a special syntax. So now you can say in the from clause after the table name, you can say, I would like to see this table as though it was at that time. And then you get the result as of that time. As of is the keyword for that. Question answered? Yes. There are also other ways to query that. You can also query the full history. You can say from, between, and all of that. It's all there. Okay. Another question. Can you do a delete or update for system time off? That's the most funny answer I have for you today. This feature is not GDPR compliant. At least, well, from standards perspective, the SQL standard does not allow you to fiddle around with the past stuff. So it also has some kind of archiving and audit trail characteristics. But when you look at each and every vendor who is implementing that, to go to on the next slide, each of them is offering some way to actually do it. Like disable the system versioning for a while, then fiddling around with the old data and then enabling it in a single transaction. So that it doesn't affect anything, this temporarily disabling doesn't affect anything outside of this transaction. Some databases have different roles. So a role that allows you to change past data. So there are solutions, it's just the standard itself doesn't offer those solutions. But yes, in fact, from standard perspective, it's not GDPR compliant, so the right of erasure is just not covered in there is no functionality from standard perspective. So, yeah, one more question. Yes, that's a table per table decision. And you can even mix and match the application versioning and the system versioning. You can have a table which has no versioning at all, then you can have which has only system versioning, automatic. You can have one with application versioning and one with both. And the syntax you have is there to keep track of all of that. Like how do the joins work to match the right point in time in the other table. It's all being taken care of. Okay? So this availability slide you see there is just about the system versioning time of thing, the fully automatic thing. And you see, MariaDB is an open source database, is now offering that for a year about. Who is using MariaDB? Yeah, you can use that. It's there, 10.3, about a year old. And if you look into the development tool, it's all open there. There are no secrets at the MariaDB. You can just look what they are working on. There are some tasks for application versioning. I'm not saying they're working on it, but there are some tickets. Okay, these were just a few features I would like to show you about how SQL has changed. And to conclude on this talk, look at this paper. You see that stack of paper? This is just one part of the current SQL standard. This part has 1,700 pages. The full standard has 4,000 pages. No, I did not waste that much paper. Only the first sheet is printed. The other ones are empty. But what do I want you to tell? When you go back to SQL 92, that looks entirely different. And since SQL 92, so since 99 actually, the relational cage was not a limiting factor for SQL anymore. And if you look at the volume, like it's as useless as lines of code, pages of specification. But it still gives you a picture. We have now 10 times as much specification in the SQL standard as we have had with SQL 92. So in other words, 90% of the current SQL language has been done after breaking out of the relational cage. If you only know relational SQL, then you know 10% or less of SQL. A lot has changed since then. I've just shown you a few features. It's a 50-minute slot. What should I do? So if there is one key message I want you to take away from this session, is SQL has really evolved beyond the relational model. If anyone is coming up and speaking, hey, for this project, we cannot take a relational database because it's bad at this or that, then your answer should be, no problem. We are not using a relational database. We are using an SQL database. And that's beyond the relational data model and the relational transformation steps. And finally, last but not least, if you're using SQL to do CRUD operations only, So mostly by primary key, insert, update, delete, select, create, read, update, delete. If you're using SQL only for that, then you are doing it wrong. You're not using SQL as it was intended to be used. SQL was always intended to be used as a transformation language from some persisted, normalized schema into many, many different ways which are convenient to implement one particular task you have at hand right now. For each and every processing purpose, a different shape of data is convenient. And SQL is the transformation language, not a query language, the transformation language to make that easy. You have seen how it can cope with JSON? That was easy. And this is what SQL was from the beginning. The transformation language between some persisted data model, which is independent of all these processing purposes, and then the more convenient things you want to have at each and every task you have at hand. And the only thing that changed actually since then is that it broke out of the relational cage. And this, my dear friends, is modern SQL. So I'm, you see, I try to convince people that something has changed over there. So I'm running a website on that, modernsql.com. You can follow it as a blog, you can follow it on Twitter. You can reach out for me. You can take stickers and coasters over there, near to the exit. And of course, you can reach out the next few hours. I have to leave at like 5 to ask me anything. But really, keep in mind, especially these three things here. It has really evolved beyond the relational model. Don't call it relational database when you mean SQL database. Okay, thank you. My name is Markus Wienand, and it was my pleasure. Oh, question. Yeah, do I have time? It's the next speaker. He says yes.
Why did all the NoSQL databases have evolved so much in the last 10 years?
Yeah, so the question is, if SQL is so powerful, why is there no SQL at all, basically? Yeah. And I think because nobody knows about that.
Really, nobody?
Did you know about it before? Who knew about it?
I didn't know.
Yeah?
I didn't
Let's
know
make a vote. So maybe five people out there who mind is now kind of blown? Yeah, many more people. You see, it's just an education thing.
Yeah, but you mentioned all the standards are very old. So, from 1999, 2003. So, why didn't the current databases implemented those features?
Okay, the standard, there are different versions, and the SQL standard is actually open. You see, these 4,000 pages, not a single database implements everything in there. Because the SQL standard is open in that sense that it offers optional features. So each of the features described in the standard is either a mandatory feature, which every database should implement if it calls itself an SQL database. So it's called core SQL, and everything else is optional features. And everything I've shown you there are optional features. Vendors may choose to implement them or not. And if there is no pressure to implement them, then they are not doing it. And the pressure is coming from us. If you want to get these things in your databases, make your vendors aware that you want to have them.
Thank you.
Welcome. Other question, yeah. So the tipping point between breaking out of the relational cage was like SQL 99. And if this is related to storage engine versus SQL design, maybe coincidentally, I don't know if it's if there's a causal relationship. Maybe not. Yeah, just because it's the same time does not automatically mean there's a connection. Okay, so I will clear the stage now for the next speaker. I'm here till about 5. Reach out if you have any questions and take stickers, take coasters. and take care. Thank you.